Can you hear me? So I have a question. I have a question for you ladies. Does this mean the potluck is canceled?
No.
Sure, yes.
Just checking. Is one of my needed to preach a long sermon or a short one?
Better go short. The battery holds out.
Anyways. Mark 4:9, the last verse that Carl read. He who has ears, let him hear. Now, do you know anybody who doesn't have ears? Well, there are a few people. Well, I suspect everybody in this room has ears. If you don't know for sure, you might want to double check. Jesus, if you have ears, hear. There's a story told of one of our presidents, which will go unnamed, that he got a little bored with the receiving lines. And he decided one day to try something comical. And as he all filed through, he said to them, "I murdered my mother-in-law." That was a safe statement made because his mother-in-law was still alive. And people would say, "Well done, Mr. King, Mr. President. Good job, Mr. President. Keep it up, Mr. President." He realized people were following through the line. They really weren't listening to what he said. The last person, the ambassador from Bolivia, came through the line, and he whispered the same thing. "I murdered my mother-in-law." And the ambassador reached up, whispered into his ears, "I'm sure she deserved it." Listening is never easy, is it? And we are so easily distracted. Let me illustrate. There's a couple, the husband is sitting at the kitchen table and he's reading the newspaper. And he says to his wife, "Wife, there is a study that shows that women speak twice as many words as men do," which actually is true. But the wife responded, "The reason we speak twice as many words as you do is because you don't listen." And his response was, "What did you say?" Many of us listen for a while, don't we? But our sensories become somewhat distracted. And before we realize it, we're already thinking about something else while someone is still talking to us. Developing good listening skills is very important. It's important at school, at the workplace, with our families, but most importantly, it is critical that we listen to the Word of God and that we hear what God is trying to say to us. So this brings us to chapter 4 of the book of Mark, the parable of the sower. Some call it the parable of the soil. It's interesting, this is the first parable that Mark has in his gospel. And Jesus is trying to tell us that we can't afford the luxury of allowing the Word of God to come into one ear and to go out the other. As we look at the life of Jesus, as we see the scenes that Mark is describing, Jesus is having difficulty with the crowds. People want to press in on him. They want to touch him. They want to be healed. And so in chapter 3, verse 9, he says to his disciples, "Get a boat," and using the reflective of the sound, he would teach and preach, which was his mission, his primary mission, to teach and preach about the kingdom of heaven. It's in chapter 3 that Jesus distinguishes between the family and the real family. The biological family and the family who does the will of God, who are his true mother, true brothers, and true sisters. And it's to the Pharisees, he says, "You must be careful that you do not reject the Holy Spirit. That you cannot rely upon your birth heritage, just as we cannot rely on having our names on the books of the record of the books of the local church." And he said, you cannot rely upon obedience to the law to save you. You need to be willing to have an intimate relationship with me, your God. Of course, they didn't like that at all. And he ends chapter 3 with this message, whoever does the will of God is my family. And so chapter 4 begins with Jesus giving this invitation. One word, listen. And in the Greek is listen, continue to listen, never stop listening. Like Jesus several times gives this command in chapter 4, verse 3. First, what he says to the crowd is listen. Verse 9, he says, he who has ears, let him hear. Verse 23, if anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. Verse 24, consider carefully what you hear. And verse 33, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could hear. So what do you think chapter 4 is about? I'm just saying if you're listening. It's about hearing, isn't it? Not only hearing each other, but hearing the word of God. And Jesus issues this solemn warning. Many people hear God's word, but never take it to heart. To continue to failure to hear constitutes the rejection of the Holy Spirit, resulting in eternal death. So in chapter 4, verses 10 through 12, Jesus issues this stern warning. As soon as he was alone, his followers, along with the 12, began to ask him, please explain these parables. Jesus loved to tell stories. The disciples said, we don't really understand these things. Verse 11, he said to them, to you has been given the mystery of the kingdom of God, but to those who are outside, get everything in parables. Verse 12, in order that while seeing they may see and not perceive, while hearing they may hear and not understand, lest they return and be forgiven. So Jesus tells the disciples, they have been called together. As they listen to these parables, that the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven are being opened to them. So what do you think Jesus means when he said to the disciples, I am revealing to you the mysteries of heaven? What do you think he means? Let's check if you're listening. What do you think Jesus means? It's important. Pardon?
That mystery is something we really don't understand.
Yes. And what Jesus is telling disciples is these mysteries about the kingdom of heaven are not hidden. But instead, it is God's intention that they be understood. And he's revealing that we cannot, on our own journey, understand the mysteries of God. We need to hear the word of God speaking into us so we can understand what his will is. So Jesus is telling disciples, I am revealing to you these mysteries, these vital truths. In verse 12, 22, he says, whatever is hidden is meant to be disclosed. It was never God's intention for man to not understand the kingdom of heaven. Paul emphasizes this in Colossians 1:26. He says, the mysteries that have been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. Jesus said, yes, there are mysteries. But it is my intention for you to understand them, that the time is now fulfilled. That's the positive side of what Jesus is saying. The negative side is that those who hear but choose not to listen are on the outside of God's kingdom. It's almost as Jesus, it almost sounds like Jesus is using parables so they don't understand. But that clearly is not what the Bible teaches. And in Matthew 13 helps us sort of understand what Jesus is saying here in 11 and 12. He says in Matthew 13 and verse 14, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is being fulfilled, which says, you will keep on hearing, but you will not understand. You will keep on seeing, but you will not perceive. The Pharisees were hearing Jesus. They were seeing Jesus. They were seeing the miracles take place. But they still did not perceive who he was. They still did not understand the importance of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus spoke in parables so that we might see the truths through these stories. That we might reflect upon those stories. That we might better understand the kingdom of heaven. But we must take care. Isaiah prophesied that there are people who would hear these parables but will not understand them or understand the truths contained in them. They will hear, but they will not listen. They will hear, but they will not take heed. They will hear, but they will not follow. And they will hear, but they will not become disciples of Jesus Christ. And Jesus' counsel to everybody within the sound of his voice was, do not be among those who hear, but do not follow. Mark 4:13 is not only a promise, but it's also a reprimand. It's also a challenge. So the disciples say, Lord, help us understand. So he said unto them, verse 13, don't you understand this parable? And if you don't understand this parable, how are you going to understand any of the parables? Sounds a little harsh, doesn't it? But Jesus is talking to them as if they're little children. Jesus is saying to the disciples, understanding this parable is the foundation for understanding all the other parables. And I'll give you the key to understand. So he encourages his disciples to apply themselves to gain an understanding. The devil is really going to challenge your listening skills today. So Jesus begins to tell this story of the sower and the four kinds of soil. Jesus is challenging us to be overcomers of our spiritual disabilities, to listen and to have humble reliance upon him. So the story is about a farmer who's going out to plant his crop. Now, when you look at a farm today, you'll see all those beautiful rows. That's not how they farmed in the time of Jesus. They would break the ground and soften the soil and throw the seed on it. Some farmers would throw the seed and then break the ground. They would tie a bag of seed around their waist and they would just cast the seed into the field. On one side of his property was usually a fence. On the other side of his property was either another fence or a hardened trail that led into town. And so it begins to talk about these seeds. Now Jesus doesn't want us to focus on every detail. One of the principles of understanding Jesus' parables is not to get lost in the details, but to look for the message. And Jesus describes the fate of the seed using four different circumstances. In the first case, the seed fell by the road where the plower's plow could not soften the soil. Verse 4 of chapter 4. And he sowed some seed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. These seeds never had a chance. As soon as they were planted, Satan snapped them out of the ground. It illustrates the danger of having a hardened heart. The second soil is verse 5, the rocky soil. Other seed fell on rocky ground where it did not have much soil. It sprang up at once because the soil was not deep. And sometimes along these fence lines there was hardened soil or maybe even tombstone or some kind of stone. And the seeds just could not penetrate. Sometimes in South Dakota you'll see along the road a crack in the asphalt. And you'll see acres and acres of sunflower trees, sunflower plants. And once in a while you'll see a lonely sunflower trying to break through that asphalt. Most of the seed that fell there did not survive. The roots could not find enough depth to draw in moisture and to anchor the plant. In verse 7, Jesus described a third kind of soil covered with thorns. He said, other seeds fell among the thorns and they grew up and it choked it and it did not produce grain. Now, most farmers will pull the native plants out of their fields. And I love the ocean. And in South Dakota, my ocean was wheat. Acres and acres of golden wheat. If it was a good farmer, he'd make sure there was no weeds on his fields. But along the fence line is where you oftentimes find weeds growing. And the seeds that fell along that fence line were those Canadian thistles. Those Canadian thistles were growing. The seeds didn't have a chance. Now farming is an investment. Just talk to any farmer, he'll tell you. He'll tell you how much money he's losing. He'll also tell you about once every 7 years, if he has a really great crop, he'll make money. And he just stores it away for the next 7 years. Because he knows if he makes a lot of money on seed, then he'll have an abundant crop. In fact, Jesus describes his abundance in verse 8. He says, a return of 30, 60, and 100-fold. And that would be abundant. And in Galilee, where they had plenty of moisture, the farmer could expect 60 to 100-fold return. But in Judea, where water was much more scarce, 10-fold was considered a blessing. How many of you here are gardeners? Well, a few of you are good. So you understand the challenges of not having rain. In Florida, we have a lot of citrus trees. When I was in El Salvador, I visited an orphanage run by a Seventh-day Adventist. And citrus trees were one thing they didn't grow because they required a lot of water. And in El Salvador, they went months without much water. And so Jesus says in this parable, we need to learn to listen. And again, in verse 9, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Now, there are two Old Testament passages that are parallel to what Jesus is saying. One is Jeremiah 5, verse 21. Now hear this, O foolish and senseless people, who have eyes but do not see, who have ears but do not hear. And Ezekiel 12, 2. Son of man, you live in the midst of the rebellious house, who have eyes to see but do not see, ears to hear but do not hear. For they are a rebellious house. In both cases, God is talking to his people who are in Babylonian captivity. And for hundreds of years, they have ignored the appeals of prophets to surrender their lives to the kingdom of heaven. And the rebellion ends them up in terrible poverty, ends them up in captivity. And two of these prophets are describing picture of stubborn rebellion. There's a saying that says, there are none so deaf as those who will not hear. So Jesus, in effect, is saying, let those who are not rebellious receive his teachings. And in verse 12, that seeing that they may see and not perceive, and hearing that they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins should be forgiven. Jesus is alluding to Isaiah 5:20. All to those who call evil good and good evil. This is what the Pharisees were doing. They were calling Jesus the source of darkness. But what is Jesus? He's the source of light. He says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Jesus understood that the Pharisees were so intent in their war against him. And no matter what he said, they were determined not to believe, not to hear, not to listen. And Jesus describes his adversaries as pictured in Isaiah chapter 6, 9, chapter 6, verse 9 and 10. And he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be healed. What a rebellious people. No matter what the prophets said, they were committed to themselves. So in chapter 4, verses 13 to 15, Jesus' explanation of his parable provides us with an interpretive key. He said to them, don't you understand this parable? How do we understand any parables? Verse 14, the sower sows the word. Verse 15, these are the ones on the path where the word is sown. Whatever they hear, immediately Satan comes up and snatches the word that was sown in them. And he tells us that the hard soil represents those who refuse to receive the word of God. Doesn't it break your heart when you're trying to talk to someone about God and they just absolutely refuse not to listen? They're so disenfranchised toward Christianity that they just cannot believe. They cannot hear. And the word doesn't penetrate them, and Satan strips them of the truth before it can germinate. Just breaks your heart when you see this kind of people. Verses 16 to 17 is the rocky soil. People receive the word of God gladly, but become disillusioned. They view God as Santa Claus. You know, you give God some money, he takes care of you. They had no idea that becoming a Christian, becoming a disciple, could have hardships. Verse 16 says, these are the ones sown on the rocky ground. As soon as they hear the word, they receive it with joy, but they have no roots in them and do not endure. Then when trouble or persecution comes because of the word, immediately they fall away. They're excited about Jesus, and when problems come, they run away. They fall away. They stumble over life's difficulties. I remember one young lady said, well, we were talking about challenges and problems. And well, my God doesn't let me have problems or challenges. Mm. You know, life is not smooth sailing, is it? There are a lot of good people who suffer. And Jesus says of the rocky soil, when they discover the hardships of real discipleship, they fall away from the word and look for some other quick fix. He says they have, verse 17 says, they have no firm root in themselves. Verses 18 through 19 is the thorny ground. Others are the ones sown among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but worldly cares and the seductiveness of wealth and desire of other things come in and choke out the word and produces nothing. anxieties, materialism, the things of this world become entangled in, and it chokes out their desire to be disciple of Jesus. Verse 20, Jesus closes the parable with a description of the good soil. But these are the ones sown on the good soil. They hear the word and receive it, and bear fruit 30 times as much as 60 and 100. They not only hear the word, but they accept it. They meditate upon it. They acknowledge its counsel to them, even when it's painful. So Mark chapter 4, 1 through 20, Jesus' message is, choose what soil you're going to be. Don't be a preoccupied believer when life's priorities choke out your faith in God. Don't allow the desires and the comforts and the power keep you in your relationship with Jesus. But allow yourself to be transplanted into good soil. His counsel is, don't be a shallow soil or a superficial seeker. But allow your roots to dig deep into God's word. Be a believer. Don't be a hard-hardened, stubborn one. Good morality has no interest in spiritual things. And ask yourself the question, how am I responding to God's word? Am I listening? Now, there's a couple of ways that we can enhance our ability to listen. First is to seek the Holy Spirit. To daily seek His indwelling presence in us. So that He can open our eyes and open our ears that we can understand. Paul says that we're natural sinners. We don't understand spiritual things without the aid of the Holy Spirit. So we need to reflect on God's word. Reflect on His principles. Secondly, we must spend time and energy understanding God's word. Jesus said in verses 24 and 25 of Mark, consider carefully what you hear. By your standard of measure, it shall be measured to you, and more shall be given to you besides. For whosoever has, to him shall be more given. And whoever does not have even what he has shall be taken away from him. And the New American Standard Bible says, be careful what you listen to. Well, good advice in one possible translation of words in question misses the point in context. Literally, Jesus is saying, see what you hear. And I like the way the New American Standard puts it. Be careful what you listen to. You have ears, use them to hear, perceive, contemplate, mull over the words of God. Let yourself be guided by His Spirit. We need to engage in God's Word. We need to work at listening to God's Word. You all have ears. The question is, will you listen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this gathering here of believers. Lord, you know how easily we are distracted. Please open our minds and our hearts that we may be able to hear you and live our lives in a way that reflects and glorifies your name. In Jesus' name, amen.